Let me ask you, young man, the mother says to Kaim 3 days later. Does the place where you're camping out have a roof to keep the dew off? Kaim has been sleeping in a dilapidated old house he found near the harbor. All I need is a place to sleep. Would you mind if I joined you there? What's that? The place I'm staying at now is not much better than a ruin. I'm sure I'd be fine wherever you're staying. Yes, I'm sure I'd be fine. She smiles like a child who has found a new source of mischief. Kaim does not refuse her. More precisely, he cannot refuse her. She has probably run out of money even to stay in her current flophouse. Kaim has noticed her cheap rings gradually disappearing from her bony fingers as they pass the night in the abandoned building. The moon, their only source of light, the mother, without prompting from Kaim, spills out memories of her son. They are by no means pleasant memories. Known as a roughneck even from his earliest years, the boy was hated by all the neighbors and caused his parents a great deal of shame. He would steal our money, stay out all night partying, and before we knew it, he was the number one thug on the island. He was always getting into fights and bothering girls. During the island's annual festival, he would go wild and destroy property, so my husband and I would have to go around apologizing to everyone. The father, a skilled stonemason, lost his job when the son stole valuables from the boss's house. The mother could hardly walk down the street without being subjected to the glares and finger-pointing of the neighbors. Things got especially bad after her son set fire to the island assembly hall just for fun. His parents raised him badly. The boy's misbehavior is the parents' responsibility. The son has become a thug because his mother spoiled him rotten. It's the parents' fault. The father's fault. The mother's fault. Your fault. They had heard it all. It was so hard for us on a little island like this. There was no place we could hide. The boy was 18 when he finally ran away from home. Or rather, left the island when his parents all but disowned him. The other islanders rejoiced as if a plague had been lifted. One man went so far as to deliberately let the parents overhear him talk, declaring, I hope that he goes to the capital and dies in the gutter. The boy's father died 5 years ago. To the very end, he would not forgive his son, and in his final delirium, he was still apologizing to the islanders. But still, to a mother, any son is the baby she once carried. I never heard a word from him, but I went on praying that he would stay healthy in the capital, that he wouldn't catch whatever epidemic was going around, that he wouldn't get into fights. But that's just me, I guess. She gives Kaim a bitter smile. Or maybe it's just me being a mother. You have parents too, I suppose. Of course you do. Everyone has parents. True. Are your father and mother alive and well? Kaim bows his head in silence. On a journey with no clear beginning and no definable end, Kaim is unable to answer a question like this. Instead, he asked the woman, "What is the first thing you'll say when you finally get to meet your son?" A good question. After thinking it over for a few moments, she replies, "I won't actually say anything. I think I'll just hug him and say nothing at all. I'll hold him tight and let him know how glad I am he's alive and well." "Just supposing, though," Kaim presses her gently, "if you knew that he had lived a less than exemplary life at the capital, would you still give him a hug?" Her response is instantaneous. "First I'd hug him, and then I'd give him a good talking to." She smiles shyly at Kaim and adds, "That's what being a parent is all about." The next morning, she runs a high fever. She may have survived the dew, but a night in the dilapidated building has taken a toll on the old woman's health. Even so, when it is time for the ferry to arrive, She struggles to her feet and heads towards the pier with uncertain steps. Alarmed, Kaim holds her back. "You're in no shape to be going out," he says. Despite his attempts to bring down her fever with cool spring water from the forest, it is as high as ever. Her labored breathing has taken a congested rumbling. "I have to go. My son is coming for me. I'm going to see him." She sweeps away Kaim's restrained hand, but the effort causes her to lose her balance and sink to her knees. "If he's on board, I'll bring him here. Tell me how I can recognize him." Cradled in Kaim's arms, half delirious with fever, the old woman mutters, "On his left cheek, before he left the island, he got in a fight. Somebody got him. He has a scar." Kaim nods and lowers the old woman to a straw mat spread on the ground. He fights back with a sigh and closes his eyes momentarily. Then he stares hard through a small window at the ferry dock. His suspicions were right after all. Though he was sure of it last night, Kaim was given a written description of the man when he took on the assignment from the gang. There could be no doubt. Scar on left cheek. The ferry is approaching the harbor. The pier is showing signs of activity. Kaim starts for the door. Behind him, he hears the woman saying,
"Please, don't kill him. Don't kill my boy."
Kaim stops short, but instead of turning around, he bites his lip.
"I don't know what he did in the capital, but please don't kill him. Please."
So she knows too. She knows everything.
"If you have to kill him, if you absolutely have to, please, before you do it, let me just..."
Kaim leaves the ruin in silence. His steps are uncertain as he makes his way into the blinding glare of the afternoon sun. This time, the man is there.